We are talking eccentric training domination, and we are starting right now. What is going on? My name is David Barr. If you're looking to get bigger, faster, stronger, get leaner, go longer, hit that subscribe and then the little bell so you don't miss the latest tips and tricks. And we are live. I'm doing a talk I've given 1,000 times before. I figured let's let everybody in on the secret. We are talking eccentric domination for strength coaches, athletes, physique athletes. This is going to change a lot. Now, I hope you have your BS detectors turned on to full, because I'm going to say a lot of things that sound like hyperbolic BS, okay? So you need to call me on it if you don't think I'm selling it, okay? Doesn't matter what your goals are, strength, power, speed, physique, it all comes down to forces, those exerted by the muscle and those exerted on the muscle, and indirectly through that, the nervous systems. It's all about forces, but we really don't think a lot about forces. And I think that needs to change to really progress in the field. Because right now, we are using about a third of our maximal force potential. I would say less than a third of our maximal force potential when we train. Now, if I told you to train with 30% of your 1RM all the time, you tell me I'm crazy, and rightly so. So the fact that we do, at best, a third of our 1RM for every rep, that needs to change. Okay. I have a question that about 95% of people get wrong. Coaches, interns, athletes, 95% of people. And it's not meant to intimidate you. It's not meant to make you feel stupid. The point is, we need to have a better relationship with forces if we're to advance the field. So we are starting off. Imagine a scenario. You are on a star of death and you are trying to save this space princess, okay? You make it to her detention block, get her out of her cell, and while you're trying to avoid blaster fire, you find yourself in a garbage disposal, a giant garbage disposal, okay? The good news is, even though there's no way out, you have some droid friends who have access to some controls. They can hook things up, get you out of there. Unfortunately, when they start trying to hack, they actually activate the garbage disposal. So the wall starts to come towards you. It starts to crush the garbage and you along with it. Now, being a trained lifter that you are, as you prepare for the end, you brace yourself against one wall and assume perfect bench press position, just instinctively to try to push against that wall. And what are to be your final thoughts are that you are exerting a ton of force right now against that wall coming in because it's eccentric. The good news is, just as the wall gets to your chest, your droid friends hack the system and reverse the wall. You are so elated, you start to scream for joy. The problem is, your droid friends think that you're being crushed. So they just overload the system. And inadvertently, they return the wall towards you, getting ready to crush you. But this time, it's at a faster pace. So now you have less time to think, but you realize, hey, I'm actually exerting more force against this wall because it's moving towards me faster, okay? It is an eccentric contraction, and because the wall is moving faster, I am exerting more force against it. It's not because of epinephrine, catecholamines, adrenaline, okay? It's biomechanics, it's the way our muscles work and the way we exert force. So in the end, your droid friends end up saving you from the garbage disposal, and you end up saving the universe with the space princess and your newfound force. Okay? So think about that for a second. You're exerting a high amount of force the first time. and then even greater amount of force the second time. So let's take a strength test. This is where it gets a little tricky. Again, this is not intended to make you feel stupid. Most people get this wrong, and the fact that we get this fundamental question wrong, to me, suggests that we have a huge opportunity for improvement. Yeah, I think this is going to be awesome. So we're sticking with bench press. Okay, we all like bench press? No? No. Okay. Well, let's pretend for the moment. For the moment, yeah, okay. I'm with you. Okay, so imagine you're starting with a load, standard bench press, and you're starting at your chest, okay? You have a 100 kilo load on the bar, 220 pounds, okay? If that bar is not moving, how much downward force is that bar exerting on you? Well, it's going to be 100 kilos, okay? And let's keep this loose, okay? No nitpicking or anything like that, okay? This is simply for illustrative purposes, okay? So that bar is exerting 100 pounds downward on you. If that bar is not moving, how much upward force are you exerting against that bar?
Less than the weight of the bar.
It's going to be exactly 100 pounds or 100 kilos because it's not moving, so that's an isometric contraction. So the forces balance, okay? So if there's 100 going down, 100 going up, it's not moving, okay? You can do it with your fists. Push your fists together really hard. It doesn't matter how hard each of them is pushing, as long as it's not moving, it's going to be an isometric contraction. Okay, they're pushing this way against each other, okay? Hey, I got to pose too. I like that. Okay, so 100 kilos up, 100 kilos down. Now, in order for you to move that bar up concentrically, how much force do you have to exert? More, anything more than 100 kilos. Awesome, okay. So now that we've kind of set the stage, hang with me on that, the questions are we stronger concentrically or eccentrically? And the simple answer is, everybody gets this right. We are stronger eccentrically, okay? Not rocket surgery. Now the trick is, when we are training with regular resistance exercise like we do 99% of the time for most people, do we exert more force concentrically or eccentrically? Now, before you answer, let's complete the walkthrough, okay? So we're back at the bench, 100 kilo load. We have to exert more than 100 pounds of force or 100 kilos of force to get that bar up, okay? So that's the concentric. We are now at lockout. Okay, so the bar is still exerting 100 kilos of force down on us, right? If that bar is not moving, how much force are we exerting upon that bar? It's going to be identical, 100 kilos. Okay, now this is the sex, okay? This is where it gets awesome. We're going to do the eccentric. We're going to lower that bar. And what people say is we are exerting more force eccentrically, okay? So what happens if we are at lockout and we try to exert more force?
You stay locked out.
You stay locked out. You can exert more force. You're already locked out. If you could exert more force, the bar would go up, not down. So in order to come down, you have to exert less force. So this is a huge paradox that I'm going to walk through, because once we understand and really appreciate this, we can really start to tap into our strength potential. So just to review, most people say we exert more force eccentrically. We actually exert less force eccentrically, okay? So there is a walkthrough I want to do to illustrate this. Are you familiar with a strength curve of a movement? What it is basically there is an amount of force that can be measured over time as you are performing a rep. Okay, and this is typically done, often done isokinetically. Okay, and it's going to look a little something like this to start. Okay, so the start of the curve is going to be you at the bottom of that bench press. Okay, and you are pressing up, and you are pressing up as hard as you can on a bar that is moving at a predetermined speed. It is controlled hydraulically. Okay, it is a machine. Doesn't matter how hard you press against that bar, it's only going to move at the predetermined rate. Okay, and there's a video I have of this so you can visualize it. I'll make sure everybody gets access to that. So you're pressing up against this bar and it is measuring your force output. Okay, that force output starts to actually increase as you move throughout the range of motion. We are not equally strong throughout all parts of range of motion, right? We have a strength curve. Some parts were stronger, some parts were weaker. Now, once we head to lockout, it starts to look like a curve. This is idealized, just again, for the sake of illustration, okay? So this midpoint is going to be mid-range. For bench, we are strongest mid-range. We can exert the greatest amount of force mid-range. Now, if you saw an athlete perform this and they had a curve that looked like this, what would that reflect? That would mean they have a really hard time locking out that bar. They're really strong up until midway, and then their strength drops off. Okay? That'll be a huge sticking point for them. All right? So this is just one rep. Now, going back to our standard curve, this is what it's going to look like for most people. All right? What if we were to do a second rep, second concentric, immediately following that first? Well, as you might expect, the force output would be lower because you've just done a rep, you've just done a max rep. You gave it everything you had, and now you fatigued, right? Even though it's only one rep, there's still some small amount of fatigue, right? Hence the lower curve. So that begs the question, what is the lowest point on the curve? That is going to represent your 1RM. The lowest point. Because what happens if I say, okay, I'm actually at 150 kilos bench press here. That's the maximum amount of force I can exert. So I load up 150 kilos on the bar. What's going to happen? I'm going to get stapled, right? Why? Because I can only exert that force for a short part of the range of motion. So what that means is if we are using this 1RM, that lowest point, our sticking point, not just for that single establishment of strength, but for every rep that follows, we are missing out on a huge amount of strength potential because it's really only focused on that one part. But nobody trains with their 1RM, right? You train with some percentage of it. So now what if you are training with 80% of your 1RM? It is going to be much lower, okay? So now look at your peak, look at what you're training with, okay? Already much lower. This difference is called your force deficit. It is how much untapped strength potential you are using when you're training with an 80% 1RM load. Now it gets fun. Let's throw in eccentric. We've only been talking about concentric. Now, not only is this higher, right? We're still training with that 80% 1RM load. In this case, just for the sake of illustration, look at the magnitude of that force deficit. So in terms of quantity, initial force deficit is going to be about a third, 33%. If we use 80% 1RM, tax on another 20% force deficit. So we're over 50% force deficit already. concentrically. Now, what happens if we throw this eccentrically? It goes through the roof. But wait, there's more. Because this does not reflect the force output during the rep. Like we talked about with that key question that everybody gets wrong, we actually exert less force during the eccentric. So that extends that force deficit even more. So we are not only extending it this way, upward, we are extending it down. This is called the bidirectional eccentric paradox, or the eccentric paradox. And it affects every single rep that we do. So once we can start to tap into this real force potential, you can imagine the implications for strength performance, power, speed, and certainly physique, muscle growth, and then by extension, fat loss. Okay? So the point of this is to introduce this topic because there is a lot going on here. And there are many, many lectures that we could do on this to expand on this. But I think for now, it's important that you just kind of let this one sink in and start to develop questions about this. I really appreciate that there is a ton of info here. And a lot of it contradicts our traditional thinking, okay? And that's okay. In fact, it's good to actually challenge our thinking. I mean, hopefully that's something we've developed over the past couple months, right? Critical thinking. Challenging, think outside the box, right? So to wrap up, the next steps are to consider your forces while training. Start to think about that. Think about the forces you are exerting on the bar, what's being exerted on you, whether you're using a bar or plyos, whatever it is. Okay, start to think in terms of forces. You don't have to quantify anything, just generalized concepts, okay? Think about if you wanted to implement heavier eccentrics, how would you do that? How would you start to chip away at that force deficit? Really take advantage of that force potential. And there are some ideas that we can discuss, and we will. And lastly, I urge you to watch that eccentric video. The other one, I'll be sure to link to it. Make sure you guys have access to it. It goes through the walkthrough with that isokinetic device so you can see what I'm talking about. All right. Okay, so you have your marching orders. Thanks for watching. I'm David Barr. Until next time, raise the bar.